various aspects of market. So one of the aspects is market structure. And what is market? Market is a system and mechanism that links buyers and sellers of a particular product. Any system, in the old times, it was used to be a physical place, but nowadays, most of the markets exist electronically. So the definition, we can define the market as something, a mechanism, a system that links the buyers and sellers of a particular product. So as a result of the interaction of buyer and seller, and based on various characteristics, markets can be classified into different categories. And based on the nature of the market, the performance of the market will differ from each other. So let us start talking about these things. So the market structure, which a firm operates, will determine its behavior. Firms under perfect competition will behave quite differently from firms which are monopolies, which will behave differently again from firms under oligopoly or monopolistic competition. So these are different categories of market structure. That is perfect competition, monopoly and monopolistic and oligopoly. And the firms operating under these market structures will behave differently. So a firm which is operating in a perfect competition will behave differently from a firm which is operating in a monopolistic competition, or for say monopoly or oligopoly. So this behavior or conduct will in turn affect the firm's performance. Performance in terms of prices of the products, profits that the firm is able to generate, the efficiency with which the firm is able to operate, etc. In many cases, it will also affect other firms' performance, their prices, profits, efficiency. So sometimes it also affects the performance of other firms operating in the same industry, in the same market. The collective conduct of all the firms in the industry will affect the whole industry's performance. And the collective conduct of all the firms which are operating in a particular market will affect the performance of the whole industry. Economists thus see a causal relationship running from market structure to the performance of that industry. So market structure impacts the conduct. Market structure will impact the conduct of the company, and the conduct of the company or firm will impact the performance of that firm. So there is a causal relationship between market structure and the performance of the firm. So economists see causal relationship between market structure and the conduct of the firm. And the conduct will result into the performance of the firm in terms of its prices, profits, and efficiency. The broad classification of market structure is in front of you. On the one extreme, we have perfect competition. And on the other extreme, we have monopoly. We differentiate these market structures based on different characteristics. For example, number of firms, type of product, ease of entry, and examples of also examples. So on the one extreme, you can see there is perfect competition, and on the other hand, on the other extreme, we have monopoly. And there are two possible in between the two possible situations which are possible between monopoly and perfect competition. So, as far as perfect competition is concerned, the number of firms which are operating in a perfect competition is large or many. So, the number of firms which are operating in a perfect competition are large number. A large number of firms operate in a perfect competition. Similar is the case with monopolistic competition also. Number of firms which are operating in a monopolistic competition is also very large. Then coming to the oligopoly, the number of firms which operate in an oligopoly are only few. And in monopoly, the number of firms is single. There is only a single firm that dominates or that owns the whole market. The whole market is owned by a single firm. So that market structure is known as monopoly. So this is one aspect, that is number of firms. In monopoly, there is only one firm. In oligopoly, there are few firms that operate in oligopoly. In monopolistic competition, there are many firms. In a perfect competition, again, there are many firms which operate in a perfect competition. Another basis on which we can differentiate these categories of market structure is type of product. So in a perfect competition, the product type is identical. Identical means they cannot be differentiated from each other. The wheat which is manufactured by one farmer cannot be differentiated from the wheat manufactured by another. So the nature of the product is identical. Identical. In monopolistic competition, the type of the product is differentiated. Differentiated means we can differentiate the product of one firm from another firm. There are some differentiating factors. It may be real difference or it may be a perceived difference. For example, Maggi, which is manufactured by Nestle, and maybe another noodle, which is manufactured by Patanjali, may have almost similar characteristics, similar ingredients. But these two products are differentiated based on the brand, based on the perception, based on label, etc. So in a monopolistic competition, the type of the product is differentiated. Type of the product is differentiated. Differentiated means we can differentiate the product manufactured by one firm from the product which is manufactured by another firm. So this is the main difference between perfect competition and monopolistic competition, that in perfect competition, the type of the product is identical. In a monopolistic competition, the type of the product is differentiated. In an oligopoly market, both situations are possible. The product can be differentiated also and identical. In some oligopolies, sometimes the product is identical. Say, for example, the oil marketing companies, the petrol which is supplied by Indian Oil or Hindustan Petroleum may not differ from each other. They are identical. But there are only few firms operating in the oil selling industry. So that is, we can classify that market as oligopoly market. But sometimes they are differentiated also. Like in case of automobiles, the car which is manufactured by Hyundai is different from the car which is manufactured by Maruti or say Renault or Mahindra. So, but there are only few car or automobile manufacturers. Then the monopoly. In monopoly, the type of the product is unique. The seller is only one, the firm is only one, and the type of the product is unique. The product is not manufactured by any other seller or any other firm. So that is why the type of the product is unique. If it is being manufactured by several firms, then it cannot be, the market cannot be termed as monopoly, because the product is being manufactured by several firms. But in a monopoly, there is a single firm which manufactures the a unique product, which is not manufactured by any other firm. Now, another point on the basis of which we can differentiate these market structures is the ease of entry or barriers to entry. How easy it is to enter into a particular industry. So in a perfect competition, it is easy for any firm to enter the market and start manufacturing the product. So the ease of entry is very high. It is very easy to enter into the market. In the monopolistic competition also, the ease of entry is very high. There are no barriers to entry. But in oligopoly, there are only few players or few firms which make the entry in the market very difficult. The entry in the market is difficult because there may be various reasons. One of the reasons is brand. Because say for example, Coca-Cola and Pepsi, so these are only two, and maybe you may recall some more names which are operating in the soft drinks industry. But if a new player enters into the same business, it will be very difficult for that firm to snatch the market shares from the already existing big players of the that. So the entry in an oligopoly market is very difficult. And as far as monopoly is concerned, the entry for new players is almost blocked. There may be several reasons, several routes through which it can be blocked. So one major reason, way to block the entry of new players is through regulations. So say for example, in India, the railway market, the railway is a monopoly of the government, or the IRCTC, for example, the ticket booking website is also a monopoly of the government. Similarly, the electricity suppliers, most of the electricity suppliers are government undertakings in a particular region. We don't have option to buy electricity from different electricity suppliers. So electricity is also one industry where the market structure is like a monopoly, which is a monopoly of the government in most of the cases. So these are some of the things, on the three things on the basis of which we can differentiate the market structure. The example of market structure, the examples are given here. So for perfect competition, agricultural products are the good example of perfect competition, because the nature of the product is identical and the number of farmers is very large, which are manufacturing or producing the agricultural products like wheat, like pulses, like rice. So these products cannot be differentiated from the products which are produced by other farmers. Similarly, in monopolistic competition, the examples of monopolistic competitions include restaurants and retail stores. So, retail stores, for example, DMart, फॉर एग्जाम्पल मेट्रो कैश एंड कैरी और एनी अदर रिटेल चेन और रेस्टोरेंट से फॉर एग्जाम्पल सीसीडी और से फॉर एग्जाम्पल मैकडी और डोमिनोज एक्सेट्रा. सो दीज आर एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ मोनोपोलिस्टिक कॉम्पिटिशन. देन ओलिगोपोली. इन एन ओलिगोपोली देर आर ओनली फ्यू फ्यू प्लेयर्स. से फॉर एग्जाम्पल द मार्केट फॉर कंप्यूटर्स. सो हाउ मेनी नेम्स यू कैन रिकॉल विच सप्लाई दी लैपटॉप और कंप्यूटर. कैन यू नेम फ्यू फ्यू कंपनीज विच मैन्युफैक्चर लैपटॉप एंड कंप्यूटर्स?
सर एप्पल, डेल, विंडोज,
HCL, HP,
तोशिबा सर,
Asus.
Toshiba. So this market can be termed as the market for computers can be termed as oligopoly market because there are few manufacturers or few firms operating in this particular industry. Similar is the case with the automobiles. So there are only few players that manufacture tractor, say for example, Eicher Motors and Mahindra, or say for example, scooters or scooty. There are only few players which manufacture it, Bajaj, Maruti Suzuki, or similar is the case with any cars also. Maybe in India, say for example, maybe 10 names of car manufacturers you can name, but not more than this. So this kind of market structure can be termed as oligopoly because there are only few firms operating in that particular market. Now coming to the monopoly, monopoly market, as we know that there is only one single firm, and the type of the product is unique. The examples include electricity. Say, for example, in Aligarh, we are able to purchase electricity from Uttar Pradesh, UPPCL, Uttar Pradesh Power Corporation Limited. So that is the only option that the residents of Aligarh have. So on the electricity supply market, the government has monopoly. Similar is the case with gas and railway services. So, any other example of monopoly that you can quote? Okay.
What was the question?
Any other example of monopoly that is coming into your mind? Example
Indian
of,
Railways.
yeah, that is a good example. Okay. What you said, Taj, what you said? Tourism? No, tourism. I mean, there are. No, tourism is not an example of monopoly because
Sir,
there are
nuclear power generation.
nuclear power generation. Yes, that market is exclusively for the government. RBI, yes, RBI is also the banker of the banks. Is also an example of
Armed forces.
armed forces. Okay.
DMRC.
DRDO. Arms
DMR.
manufacturing.
Sir,
Nowadays,
DMRC.
arms. BMRC, Bombay Metro Rail Corporation. Okay. That is good example of monopoly. Delhi Metro Rail Corporation, Delhi Metro. That is also a kind of monopoly. And
हिंदुस्तान जिंक लिमिटेड.
Hindustan.
So in the current situation, we can also take the example of COVID manufacturing vaccines that are being manufactured in the today's time. There are only certain companies, like Serum Institute only, that are manufacturing.
Yes. And the owner of Serum Institute has just recently rented an accommodation in London, the most costly accommodation. He has gone there and spent a lot of money on that vacation, and that news was in the media. So he is enjoying the fruits of investing in the COVID vaccine manufacturing. So yes, Serum Institute is has almost a kind of monopoly in the vaccine industry. Of course, AstraZeneca, Oxford, they have came up. They have conducted the research and development, but Serum Institute actually manufactures these vaccines. Not only Serum Institute manufactures the vaccines of COVID, but also all the other vaccines which normally kids are supposed to take. For example, the vaccine for TB, the vaccine for malaria, the vaccine for all other usual diseases that are normal. So, and the interesting thing is that Serum Institute of India is a private limited company. It's not a public limited company. And he is one of the wealthiest person of India, despite owner of a private limited company. So that is interesting thing about Serum Institute. So that is good example of monopoly. And that monopoly is basically driven by patenting and R&D. It's not because of regulations. It's mostly because of expertise or licensing and patents. So license and patents can also be a source of monopoly. Any other example? Adar Poonawala. His name is Adar Poonawala. Adar Poonawala. So people are debating whether it is justified to spend so much money on a vacation or not. So some people are saying it is his money. He can spend the way he wishes to spend. Now let us talk in detail about perfect competition or perfectly competitive markets. Perfectly competitive market, a market that meets the conditions of many buyers and sellers, all firms selling identical products, no barriers to new firms entering the market. So these are the three basic characteristics of perfectly competitive markets. The first one is many firms, many buyers and sellers. The second condition is all firms are selling identical products. And the third condition is, the third characteristic is that there is no barrier on the entry of new entrants. New players can enter into the market easily. So a perfectly competitive firm cannot affect the market price. So this is the important thing, that in a perfectly competitive market, a single firm cannot impact the price of the product. A single firm cannot impact the price of the product. So every firm in a perfectly competitive market is price taker. Every firm in a perfectly competitive market is a price taker. price taker means it cannot impact the price of the product. Just a few minutes. Okay. So in a perfectly competitive market, every firm is price taker, a buyer or seller that is unable to affect the market price. So the demand curve in a perfectly competitive market looks like this. The price is given, that is $4 per bushel. Per bushel of wheat, the price is $4 and the demand is unlimited. So a single firm can sell any amount of product, any quantity of the product at the given price. So the price is $4, and at this price, the firm can sell any number of output, any number of the product. So this is the how the demand curve looks like in a perfectly competitive market for a single firm. For a single firm, the price is given. It cannot impact the price because the price is determined by the forces of the market, that is demand and supply. So, and there are large number of buyers and large number of sellers in a perfectly competitive market. So a single firm cannot impact the price of the product. So the price is given. So, so the firm can sell theoretically infinity, you know, the number of products at the given price. So here, in this graph, the first graph is for the market for wheat. So the blue line is actually the demand for wheat, and the red line is the curve or the line for the supply of the wheat. And as they interact with each other, the price of wheat is fixed. The price of the wheat is fixed by the interaction of demand and supply, and in this case the price has been fixed as $4 per bushels of wheat. This is what happens for the whole market. But as far as a single firm is concerned, for a single firm, the price is given and the demand is unlimited for a particular, farmer. For a single farmer, the demand is unlimited because the single farmer can sell any amount of wheat at the given price. So the market demand for wheat versus the demand for one farmer. The farmer, say for example, the name of the farmer is Parker. So Parker has to sell the wheat manufactured by him at the price which has been fixed by the forces of market, that is demand and supply. So a single farmer, Parker, cannot sell, you know, the wheat at a price which is fixed by him. He cannot fix the price. He has to sell the wheat at the price which is fixed by the market. So this is what happens in a perfectly competitive market. And agricultural products are the examples of perfectly competitive market. So that is why the example includes mention of wheat. Now coming to the the next question, that is, what is the maximum level of profit for a perfectly competitive market for a firm which is operating in a perfectly competitive market? what is the optimum level of profit? So the optimum level, so excuse me, so the optimum level for a firm which is operating in a perfectly competitive market is, we will talk about that later on, but before that, this is the basic concept that the profit of a firm is equal to total revenue minus total cost. Total revenue minus total cost is the profit for a particular firm. So revenue of a firm in a perfectly competitive market, and we are also aware of the concept of average revenue and marginal revenue. Average revenue, when we divide the total revenue by the number of products sold, that gives us the figure of average revenue. Similarly, marginal revenue, the change in total revenue resulting from selling one more unit of product, that is known as marginal revenue. Marginal revenue is this, change in total revenue divided by change in quantity. So basically, what is the question? The question is, what is the optimum level of profit for a firm which is operating in a perfectly competitive market or perfect competition? So in a perfect competition, yes. So this is a table which shows the total revenue, average revenue, and marginal revenue for the farmer, for a single farmer. So say for example, if the farmer is selling only one bushel, he will sell that one bushel at $4, and his total revenue will be 4, his average revenue will be 4, and his marginal revenue will be 4. And if he sells 10 units of 10 bushels of wheat, in that case, he will be able to sell at the same price, that is $4. And he will be able to sell at the same price. The price will remain same because this is a perfectly competitive market or perfect competition. And his total revenue will be 40. 40, that is 10 multiplied by 4, that is 40, total revenue. When total revenue is divided by the number of bushels, that is 10, it will give us the figure of average revenue per bushel. And this is marginal revenue, which is the change in the total revenue. That is, change in the total revenue is 36 to 40. The change is 4. So 4. So what we can observe in this table is that the average revenue and the marginal revenue both are same. So in a perfectly competitive market, in a perfect competition market, the AR is equal to MR. AR is equal to MR. AR is equal to MR. Average revenue is equal to the marginal revenue. This is what happens in a perfect competition, and so the profit maximizing level of output is, the profit maximizing level of output is also where marginal revenue equals marginal cost. The profit maximizing level for a firm which is operating in a perfect competition is a level where the marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost. And in the previous table, we saw that average revenue is equal to marginal revenue. So we can write this like this also. AR is equal to MR is equal to MC. Average revenue is equal to marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost. So the level, the point, the level at which average revenue is equal to marginal revenue and both are equal to marginal cost, that level is the profit maximizing level. Profit maximizing level. So the level at which average revenue is equal to marginal revenue and marginal cost, that level is profit maximizing level for a firm which is operating in a perfect competition. So in terms of graph, we can show the same relationship. The profit maximizing level we can show like this. Just give me one. So look in this graph. This the two cost curves. The first one is the marginal cost curve that we already know that is the shape of the marginal cost curve and average total cost curve is always U shape, and the marginal cost curve cuts the average total cost curve from below. So the same. They have been drawn in the same way. But as far as the demand curve is concerned, demand curve or marginal revenue curve, both are same. MR and demand, both are same in this case, that is a straight line, and P. So basically, this is P is equal to MR is equal to demand. All these three things are same. And so the price is this price line, the demand line is the blue line. And the average total cost is here. This point is the average total cost. And the gap that is between average total cost and the marginal revenue. This is marginal revenue. This line is for marginal revenue. The blue line is for marginal revenue. And this yellow curve is for average cost. This is for average cost. And this is the gap. So if we draw a box from this point to this point, and this point to this point. So this is a rectangle. So if we calculate the area of this rectangle, area of rectangle, that will give us the profit of the firm. Profit of the firm. So profit of the firm is equal to this area. And in another word, this area can be defined as price minus average cost. Price per product, P minus average cost and multiplied by quantity. So this is per unit profit multiplied by Q. The number of units that the firm is selling, that will give us the figure of total profit. Total profit. So total profit is equal to price minus average cost multiplied by Q. Price minus average cost or average total cost, both are same thing, multiplied by what is this? This is total profit of the firm. Total profit. Total profit of a firm which is operating in a perfect competition. In a perfect competition, the demand curve is given. The price at which the firm can sell the product is given. So it cannot change the price of the product. So that is why this is a line. The demand curve is a line. And the cost curve, you know. So the only option the firm can maximize its profit is by reducing the average cost. Because this P cannot be changed. This P cannot be changed in a perfect competition because a firm is a price taker, not a price giver. It's a price taker. So the only way it can maximize the profit is by reducing the average cost of production, average cost per unit. And another way to increase the profit is by increasing the quantity of the product that the firm is selling. So these are the two options. The Q can be varied, average cost can be varied, but price cannot be varied. Price cannot be controlled by a single farmer, by a firm which is operating in a perfect competition. So again, I'm repeating these same points just to make it clear. Okay. Give me a few minutes. So in a perfectly competitive market, actually you should be able to draw these graphs by your hand. Using mouse, it is somewhat difficult for me. But let me try. This is quantity, this is price and cost. So in a perfectly competitive market, the price is given. This is price. Price is also marginal revenue and price is also average revenue. Then a marginal cost curve looks like this. And marginal cost curve. Then we have average cost curve, which looks like this. This is average cost curve, which cuts the marginal cost curve from above. So this is the point where marginal cost curve cuts in average cost curve. So the point where marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue, marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue. So this is the point. If we draw a line from here to here, so this area is the area of profit. So if average cost is below the marginal revenue, if the average cost is below the price, the firm will make a profit. Again, I'm repeating the same thing. If average cost is below marginal revenue, or in other words, below the price, because price is this level is the price. If the average cost is below this point, that is a situation where the firm will make a profit. And if the average cost is above the price, if the firm is not able to produce at a price, at a cost which is less than the market price of the product, in that situation, if phone will incur a loss. So in this graph, the situation where the firm is making a profit has been demonstrated. Why? Because the average cost here, the average cost is below the market revenue or the price. The price is more than the average cost of production for the firm. So that is why the firm is making a profit. This is a green area. The firm is making a profit. And we can calculate the total profit by multiplying the profit per unit multiplied by quantity that the firm is selling. Okay, thank you very much. We will continue the same thing in the next class. And let me save the attendance.